This is a continuation of a screencast in which we have a system of multiple reactions occurring in a CSTR, and we need to do both material balances and an energy balance in order to solve this problem. In the previous screencast, we've done the material balance part, which is parts A and B of this problem, and now we want to do part C, which requires an energy balance, where we want to maintain isothermal operation of this CSTR by using a heating jacket for these endothermic reactions, in order to keep the temperature constant during the reaction. And so the overall heat transfer coefficient is given as 22.5 watts per meter squared Kelvin, and so we want to solve for the required heat exchanger area. Okay, to do this, we need to set up an energy balance on our system. Here, the amount of heat that we have to add is going to be equal to the heat that's required from the first reaction, which is given by the number of moles of A that are reacted, times the heat that was required in this case per mole of A reacted. And then we have a second reaction, and so the heat that's required for that reaction will be how much U is made in the reaction times the amount of energy that's required per mole of U that's made. Right, that's going to be equal to the heat that we have to add to the reaction system. And here in this system, we're given that it's isothermal, so the temperature inside the reactor and at the outlet is actually equal to the inlet temperature. Therefore, there are no specific heat effects from the fluid that's flowing through the reactor. So in other words, from convective flow, we're bringing in the same amount of energy that we're taking out. And so there's a net cancellation, and we don't have to have those effects that depend on the flow rate of the reactants and the heat capacity and the temperature. Right now, we need information about the heats of reaction in the system, and those are given above. So if we look at this data table, we see that we're given enthalpies of formation for all the different reactants and products, and we can use the stoichiometry in order to actually compute the heat of reaction. So let's do that now. The enthalpy change due to reaction 1 is equal to the heats of formation of the products. In this case, our product is D times its stoichiometric coefficient. So the heat of formation for D is negative 7 kilojoules per mole. We multiply that by 2, all right, minus the reactants, which have stoichiometric coefficients of 1, and so there's a heat of formation of component A of negative 12, and a heat of formation of component B of negative 5.1 kilojoules per mole. We can find that the enthalpy change due to reaction 1 is equal to 3.1 kilojoules per mole of A that's consumed from this reaction, and so we'll end up plugging that in here. Similarly, the heat of reaction 2 is products minus reactants. Our only product is U with a heat of formation of 5.5 kilojoules per mole. We subtract off the heat of formation of the reactant D, which is negative 7 kilojoules per mole, to get an overall heat of reaction of positive 12.5 kilojoules per mole for this endothermic reaction. Now we have these two variables for the heats of reaction. All right, to get FA0 minus FA, that's the same as the volumetric flow rate, total volumetric flow rate, which is given in the problem as 20 liters per minute, right, times CA0 minus CA, which has been also given previously in the problem. This difference is equal to 1.5 moles per liter, and so we know these values. We furthermore know that the molar flow rate FU is equal to the volumetric flow rate times the concentration of U exiting the reactor, and that was solved for in our previous problem, and then it is equal to 0.9 moles per liter. And so now we have all the values on the right hand side of this equation, and we can solve for Q dot. And I find that Q dot is equal to 5.3 kilowatts. To get the units of kilowatts, I had to convert minutes. The volumetric flow rate is given in terms of units of per minute. Had to convert that to per seconds, which allowed me to get kilojoules per second. We now know how much heat has to be added, and so we can relate that to the amount of heat exchange area that we need in this problem. And so the overall rate of heat transfer is equal to an overall heat transfer coefficient times the area that we're trying to solve for the jacket, times the temperature difference across which the heat is being transferred. We're given in this problem values for each of these, and so we're given, for example, that the overall heat transfer coefficient is 22.5 watts per meter squared Kelvin. We're given that the temperature in the reactor is 298 Kelvin, and we're given that the temperature of the steam that's in the cooling jacket is 473 Kelvin. And so now we have everything we need in order to solve for our unknown, which is the required heat exchange area. We have to do a simple conversion of kilowatts to watts. And when I plug in the numbers and convert and then solve for the area, I get around 1.3 meters squared for the required heat exchange area, which is not very large, in order to supply enough heat to keep the reactor operating isothermally. And so here we see really the key to this part of the problem where we have multiple reactions is that we have to take into account the heat that is required, the energy that's required, to do both reaction one and reaction two. And so we do that by keeping track of how many moles of A are consumed in reaction one and multiplying that by how much energy that requires, and then how much of component U is generated in reaction two and how much energy that requires. Right, this would be a more complicated calculation if instead of keeping track of these components that are only involved in a single reaction, so if we go back up here, if we kept track of components that are only involved in a single reaction, so components A and component U, that lets us just focus on each reaction in the series and the heat that's required for each of those reactions. It would be a more complicated process and therefore one that we would choose not to do if we were trying to use the moles formed of D in this process, since it's involved in multiple reactions.